And we're going to continue this conversation in a little bit, but now I'd like to turn to Mei Lin Fung. And you are one of the co-founders of Franchise for Humanity. I understand there are some similarities between Franchise for Humanity and Program for the Future, but what is the main thrust of your organization?
So Franchise for Humanity came out of my work with customer relationship management. In 1988-89, many years ago, we used technology and we redefined the way sales and marketing was done. But what I had hoped for, which would be a relationship-enhancing technology, ended up being a way in which businesses could control their customers and sort of went off in a different direction than I ever expected. That's when I realized it was really important to have the social innovation within our social institutions and our social processes so that we could take this technology and use it to enhance our humanity and not just make more money, get more revenue out of a single customer. So Franchise for Humanity is really saying that we as people have to decide what is it that we want. This technology is wonderful, but it's like fire. This is something that Doug Engelbart said. He said, technology is like fire. It can burn you up or you can harness it. We have to decide what we want to do with our humanity. Where should we, what should our families be like? What will our schools be like? What do we want our children's lives to be like? We need to decide that now, because we have a most incredible tool that connects us and helps us communicate to people around the world, and that has never happened before.
Now, does Franchise for Humanity have a specific vision of the way you want those things to be?
Franchise for Humanity respects the individual. So we want to catalyze human potential so that people can be all that they can be, that respect and dignity of the individual is paramount. And somehow that has got lost as we've looked at technology and thought, oh, what neat and cool thing can we do? So Doug Engelbart talked about the coevolution of the human and the tool system. And we've had terrific innovations in the tools, but now we have to evolve our social infrastructure, our social institutions, so that we can harvest the benefits of those tools for the things that are most meaningful and important to us as humans. Last night I was at a conference put together by the Churchill Club about the future of work. And it was very rational, and I stood up at the end of it and I said, we have not heard a single thing about families, about compassion, about nurturing, about what we want our children's lives to be like. And that theme was taken up by other speakers through the conference.
Now, are you talking about changing people's behavior, or are you talking about changing the institutions, or both?
I think when we as a society get into a place of great disruption, we don't know where's up and what's down, we need to center ourselves, we need to decide and remember what's important to us. In a way, we've been so disrupted by the promise of technology. It seems like, oh, let's press another button, let's try another gadget. But what is it all about? Do we care about how our parents' lives are? Do we care about aging? Do we care about the quality of life? Are we paying the right attention to that? That's what I saw with customer relationship management. It was supposed to be about relationships. It ended up being customer service representatives being told, do not spend more than 2 minutes on each person. And the technology was there to control that would happen. And so people became very dissatisfied. They lost human intimacy. They lost human touch. They said, why am I doing business with this company that I hate doing business with? It becomes very frustrating. So I've seen how it goes off the rails, and I think it's very, very important that we speak up. Particularly, I think the answer is in plain sight. We talk about the evolution of our social institutions. How is that going to happen? Oh my goodness, you know, who's going to change it? The answer is right there. There are women, there are families, there are children, there are people who care about the future. Let's mobilize them, let's empower them, let's engage them. That's what Franchise for Humanity is about.
Okay, very good, and we're going to get back to that subject, but first, we have some video from your recent Franchise for Humanity conference at Stanford University. We have some interviews with some of the attendees, so let's go ahead and roll that tape.
Basically, a sustainability project, and it's about how can we make a sustainable version of liquid fuel? How can we increase our available freshwater supplies? how can we make local food supplies, and how can we do all of this without damaging the environment? And I've been working on a solution to that problem, at least for coastal cities, for these last 6 years.
And what does that solution look like so far?
So the solution we call OMEGA. It stands for Offshore Membrane Enclosures for Growing Algae. It turns out microalgae are an incredibly good source of liquid fuel. Algae make lots of oil. In fact, 90% of the fossil oil we currently get from the deep earth or under the ocean comes from microalgae. And these microalgae not only make oil, usable oil, but they can grow on wastewater. So we can grow them on sewage from our cities. So we can grow the algae on wastewater, and there are freshwater algae growing in these containers as we envision the Omega system floating offshore. So we're not using land, we're not using water, we're not using fertilizers, we're not competing with agriculture to make a biofuel.
So algae basically turns into something like oil that can burn?
Exactly. You can make the algae, you can process this algae biomass into a fuel. And the algae not only took wastewater and grew on the nutrients in the wastewater, but they took carbon from the atmosphere to grow because they're doing photosynthesis. So they use carbon dioxide. That's a greenhouse gas. So they capture carbon, they clean the wastewater, and they're freshwater algae living in a marine environment. So if they escape into the environment, they die. So they can't damage the environment. I am hoping that I'll make connections here with people who can reach out into the world and help to develop this technology. I mean, I'm a scientist, and I've been thinking about how to technically solve the problem. There are a lot of social hurdles that need to be overcome. How do you get people to take on this new challenge? People are not behaving as though they really see the crisis that is coming.
Right now, the reason I think social innovation is taking off so well is that we really have a perfect storm of demographics. We have the baby boomers who are entering what a lot of people call the purpose years of their lives. They've made their mark in the world. They've made their money. They want to know, what's my purpose? What legacy am I leaving behind? And so they are actually transitioning, in a lot of cases, to running nonprofits, serving in public service. And so we see that big movement happening. In conjunction with that, you've got the millennials, who are their own unique group of people, born after 1982. And this group, Deloitte just published a great study on millennials, and they talk about the fact that this group is very in tune to purpose, to that businesses need to be providing social value, not just profit, and they're going to be pushing from within organizations to make that happen. The Nature Conservancy is an organization that I just greatly admire. They won 3 Edison Awards last year for some of their incredible innovations along the lines of self-perpetuating systems. They created a water trust fund, I can't remember if it was Brazil or Colombia, where they are actually have the utility company, the largest Coca-Cola bottling company, the government, and the ranchers all working together to manage the use of the water. So everyone wins. The ranchers are being paid not to graze certain areas so that the watershed is protected. And in return, the utility company is saving money on some of the recovery fees they would have normally had to for the wastewater treatment. And the government's winning because they don't have to, you know, it's basically creating an ecosystem that is paying for itself. So after the initial infusion of money to create this fund, it now becomes a self-perpetuating system.
Well, ever since I was, maybe 30 years old, I had this crazy dream to transform the planet for the better. But I thought, how ridiculous is that? And now here we are with a real opportunity to do exactly that.
And what sort of transformation do you think is required?
Well, I was hoping that the governments would sort things out, but failing that, I've been looking to global businesses. I've been supporting Japanese globalizing businesses and solving global problems profitably and sustainably and helping them learn to work together as they expand overseas and include diverse members in their teams.
What do you think the big problems are that need to be solved?
Mostly pretty simple. Like human beings need to trust each other. They need to learn to communicate, hammer out some shared goals that bring them together, and realize that they're not going to get where they want to go unless they help each other. I know almost no companies now that think they're just in business to make a profit. All of them feel they have some purpose beyond profit. And maybe it's just corporate hype, but I have to believe that it's authentic. Otherwise, I can't get out of bed in the morning.
Now, with all your clients, what do you actually do? What do you offer to those clients? What business do you in?
I do what I call workshops. team effectiveness, global leadership, creativity, and innovation work shocks to shock people into waking up to what's possible and to doing what seems impossible but is merely difficult through the power of the group genius. And I have my seven favorite things I'd like everyone on Earth to have: clean drinking water, healthy food, education, healthcare, clean sustainable power, and access to sanitary toilets, and, well, I forget what the seventh one, how about some fun to enjoy their lives?
Well, that was our video of the Franchise for Humanity at Stanford University.